because she was so impressed by how much you were involved with. She liked very much the idea that there was a curator who would show things, but she also wanted to be part of it. So she, I think, had confirmed that. She wanted to be involved in that also. She would talk about the aspects of the Democrats, and that meant we will all agree with what she said. It's interesting because I would say to her, this was in the early 90s, so I think you have something to say about color. She said, I really like that. I really like that. And then about 5 years afterwards, she said to me, I've been making color work. She didn't tell me that. She said, I wanted 12-foot pictures before I made, said I'm doing color. It was interesting, she really did take a lot of time, and she was she didn't tell me she was involved in that, which was, usually she couldn't keep secrets for very long, but she kept that going. I can say something about Lorraine, too, I'm glad you mentioned so much about the humor, because that was very big in the and there was a time that everybody was saying, well, all these pictures are so cold and clinical, and it was not true anyway, and people weren't looking, and Lynne would always say, well, if you think they're cold, put on a coat.
She was very much an artist's artist. One had to know something also to see to really see her work. But at the same time, she was able to talk to students, to be there, to communicate with them, to be simple, to be direct, to open them up to these ideas, which are not superficial at all. Like as much as I understand this too, this idea that her pictures are cold, but once you've looked at enough of them, I mean, they're also so funny. I mean, not all of them, obviously, but that's such an important thing, and she would teach the students to see that. So there was, in there, she was teaching art at the same time as being just a nice person and a good teacher, and
I think the important thing then is to our work is to look at it. Because people don't look at work very much or don't give much time to it. But her work does repay looking. And I think Anne did something in the show, the recent show, they had this iPad thing you can listen to it. And at the end she says, you know, if you don't see it, look more. Look more. And I think that anybody can get them if they look. I remember her mother, we took her mother to see a show at, in the old National Gallery, which used to be on Belgian Street, and there was a modern gallery, and she mother said, well, you know. She said, well, let's sit down here for a few minutes and take a look. And it was called Signal, and then after a while, of course, we retrofitted, you know, you see the signal. It's not jumping. My mother thought that was just so fantastic. The moment she actually sees something. But people come to that. And I think they really, the pays looking. No, I'm a fan. But I think it's true.
Thank you, Andrew. Are there other questions or observations?
One thing, can I just say this?
Yeah. Mindful?
I'd just like to underscore one of the experiences that Lynne offered, which is very rare. She was part of a community that restructured and rethought the whole sense of what the University of Ottawa Visual Arts Department was about. She came in at a time that there was a major transition, great support from the university administration, for us to actually do something that might make sense on a much broader level than it was being offered in the broader community. And Lynne was part of a group of people that challenged the whole sense of what interdisciplinarity was about. So when you look at her work, it's not just a question of seeing the surface traces that one sees, but an incredible subtlety of nuance between what might be called the privileged moment and what might be called the public moment. She understood that incredibly well, and that was a major gift in her sense of pedagogy that she offered to the University of Ottawa. The University of Ottawa had been struggling with the whole sense of what a program was about and where it should go. And we would to, and it was Charles, myself, Penny Cousinosi, Van Cousino, Agarron, and Lynne, we would get into these really raucous meetings. And in the early stages, you were still allowed to smoke in the department, the university, let alone in the department. At that time, Lynne smoked the pipe. And Charles Gagnon had cigarettes. And they would sit at opposite ends of the table, and they would debate as to the quality of the smoke that was coming out. And this annoyed the heck out of me because I thought we were there for something much more serious, not realizing the actual depth of what she was offering, or what Charles was offering. And we would get into these incredibly animated conversations, myself in a very pompous way exploring the ideas, art speak of what photography and Lincoln was all about. And Lynne would take a pipe out of her mouth and she would very quietly say something very succinct. It would irritate the heck out of me because I had spent so much time exploring the idea, she was able to say it so much more simply and with a conciseness and accuracy that just went right to the source. But it's that kind of perspective that offered to the University of Ottawa an incredibly coherent and valuable program that when you look at the legacy of what actually went through the program, she was instrumental and critical to the development of it. And for that, I as an artist in working in my own discipline will be grateful for the rest of my life. We had contentious times, we had remarkably tender times, we had argumentative times. It was a time of great life and spirit that somehow gets lost in the current sense of what art making and what a department is about. Lynne was a major contributor in that context.
Thanks, Michael. I think it all reveals itself in what comes out, correct?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Anne, you wanted to say something?
Actually, just something we haven't really touched on in terms of how Lynne started to present her work in for Mica frames. Just going back to what Andrew said, she was, Anne was very reluctant to move with the microframes, and I think Craig Lavarish was in the audience somewhere, and he was the designer at the time, I think. Or was We went through two phases. One, Michael Kramer's came later. So Lynn would always enjoy very much, she was giving a lecture, if I was in the audience, she'd say, well, there's some curators don't understand Michael Kramer's. Which had a really interesting rationale for you, and so on. And then, of course, the pages in the catalogue for No Man's Land are blow-ups, just to, you know, dig it in a little bit. They blow us from Michael Kramer's. So. And I think she and Bill really enjoyed that part of the design. But we also
didn't. You didn't.
No, I didn't. Actually, I still don't like that part of the design. But we also went through a phase when we were doing environments here now. This was extremely interesting because Lynn wanted the pictures both to be more political, more open, more sort of enterable into. And I don't know if you remember, Craig, but we were making those seamless plastic sleeves out of plexi and putting the pictures into this so that they would just kind of sit on the wall. And then it was
so serious.
And it was so expensive. It was 80s, but yeah. So she had that sculptural sense still of how to present the work and how to work in space. So I just, like, you know, it was one thing we kind of didn't talk about.
To expand upon that a little bit, there were a couple of pages of Lynn's work where she was doing, taking black and white images and working with color frames. And she always tried to pick a color that she felt reflected some kind of ambiance within the photo. And people to this day will swear that an image that is black and white is a color image because it was placed in one of those color frames. And they see that color emerging when they think about that.
That's interesting. Just an observation of my own about the framing. I think, judging by the conversations I've had with people, I know it's something that continues to set them on edge a bit. A lot of people have questioned the frames and why are they so in your face and so forth. And I think part of the issue is, you know, the frames started to make the photograph into an object in itself, and I think Lynn was quite conscious of that, quite deliberately, and, you know, for microframes, recall that artificial world that she was photographing and created an echo. But it strikes me that one of the difficulties that that framing presented was the way that it challenged a boundary that for most people was assumed and implicit, and it was a boundary between mediums in the sense of a photograph was something that you went into, that you read, that was all about its subject and maybe careful composition or whatever. But a sculpture, on the other hand, was an object and a thing in your own space. And I think it was that dissonance, because Lynn's framed photographs at a certain point, especially, were both objects in your own space and, as you put it, you know, intuable. And I think that it's part of that. It seems, you know, looking back on it, it's, you know, in one way it seems, why not? Why shouldn't she? But at the same time, I think it was a very considered decision, and that had a lot to do with challenging boundaries. Yes.
I'm wondering then, I remember when Lynn was telling me one day how excited she was to have these Formica frames. And I had problems with them, looking at them, and it didn't occur to me to ask her at the time, and perhaps you know, had she pre-visualized the frame? Like, when I shoot, I see the finished object. For me, it's very important. It's part of everything. And I'm wondering, was she thinking Formica when she was shooting the images that were framed? I mean,
panel
where...
Pre-vision,
is that an after decision? Is that,
maybe I can answer that.
I mean, Michael used to speak constantly about pre-visualization. And
she had a lot of Pamaka samples, but I don't think she was actually taking them when she was photographing, and it would not better. I think it was afterwards. She was looking at the print, and there was information in the print that she felt could be drawn out or even opposed in a way by using those Pamaka frames. She had an extremely good rationale for it. She had looked at a lot of Baroque and Italian paintings from the 17th century, and she talked a lot about how frames picked up on objects in the stolen paintings or even in the portraits where there were objects. So she thought very much about the correlation. And I think she liked the edge and the fact that people were like discomforted by it. And then because she had a range of things, didn't she, Erin? Different painted things.
It was afterwards because she would she'd have a large number of these tropical micro samples, and she would be putting them together with the image and leaving it and thinking about it, which ones worked and which ones didn't. So, and they were often quite different. There was a lot of thought I did at the times. What she said was very much in her mind, but also she didn't want a house done. She thought that was a problem, that museums would take a picture and they would all go in the same frame and, you know, that it would be just a house done. She said, no, I want to be in control of the whole thing. And of course, the Paul Michael, which are fantastically beautiful and fantastically expensive because, you know, they're one piece, they're not constructed. So basically you buy a huge piece of Paul Michael, take out the middle and that's it. And she was, you know, it was a lot of thought put into it. And when she moved to color, of course you can't use the color frames because then it's too much. So all the color, after she was doing color, you get very muted. You may get dark brown, dark green, dark, you know, gray or something like that, but still all micro frames. And she liked the beauty of it. She liked it because those frames are really beautiful. And she liked that. You see, and that was an important thing for her.
One is an anecdote, another is an observation. We were talking at one point, and the word kitsch came up. And someone had accused Lynne's work of not only dealing with kitsch, but being kitsch. And her response was very simply, she said to the individual, or said to me, that if any individual considered her work kitsch, or dealing with kitsch, she would offer to photograph their living room. that was a very succinct comment. The other was, a number of years ago, I had the opportunity, which I do regularly, driving across Canada, and I was at the Winnipeg Art Gallery, and I saw the collaborative effort between the National Gallery and the Winnipeg Art Gallery. And I was perplexed initially before getting there as to how they would handle it, because I knew that it was going to be a really big show, but it was going to be a very precise show. And what struck me about it was the sequencing and the chronology of it. And it made me realize something about Lynne's work that forced me to go back to both No Man's Land and Occupied Territories that is very subtle underneath the surface that's certainly being seen in this particular image. The last image that was in the exhibition in Winnipeg was a photograph that was entirely different, or presumably very different than any of the other works that she had done. It was a work that was more introspective, had more to do with the sense of passage from one space to another. In the visual sense, it was a window going into a window going into a door. I can't remember the actual structure of it, but it was a very important, it was done in 2013, which was towards the final times. And I looked at that image, and I remembered it in relation to an image that is in the Ottawa Art Gallery exhibition right now. It's a 5x7 photograph, a contact print of a corner of a room. And that directed between those two moments made me realize something about Lynne's work that almost talks about the comedian's sleight of hand or the magician's sleight of hand. The comedy is the sleight of hand. The depth of her work also functions on a level of what I would suggest is that of passage and the vulnerability of passage. So when you look at her work in a much more introspective way that seemed to be happening by herself in the final years of her work, dependent on this particularly last image that I saw, there is a profound sense of passage and the value of humanity's values and how they become generated and thrown out. And that wasn't just an issue of evidence for me or for what Lynne was speaking to at the end. It was more a questioning of what we really want to embrace in our sense of humanity that really mattered. And that last photograph of, I'm hoping that, and you know the one I'm talking about?
I think so. I think it's, did you take the keyboards, the one with the wind, it's like a try to tell that you're looking through a hole in a wall and it goes on.
There's just this incredible, profound sense of passage from one thing to another.
It's color, it's quite beautiful.
It's color, and it's incredibly
subtle. It looks a bit like a Jim Terrell.
Yeah. No, it's incredibly subtle.
It's an extremely special bankbook.
It drops the whole appearance of what one would presume you would get from a Lynne Cohen photograph. And in reality, when you go back to the other photographs that are very much part of her oeuvre, that particular sensitivity is there. But it's always underneath the surface. It's a very subtle element that comes through. It's quite remarkable to see that kind of insight.
I have a question for Lorraine, actually. Lorraine, when I was thinking about this panel and thinking about the two participants on the panel, I realized that your own work, you're a photographer, of course, and that your own work looks at these external world, so one could say, oh, it's the opposite of Lynne's. But then at the same time, I know that you also reflect on construction and artifice and the engineering of the environment, both from an ecological point of view in your earlier work and in a more formal sense in your later work. And I wonder if you feel a personal affinity with Lynne's vision. I wonder what influence she had on you.
Wow. Well, it's a challenging question because I personally probably always thought that, well, I still do, that we were just completely different. So the only thing that brings us together would be that we use photography, sometimes using a larger format. But I think I would say that where her work influenced me the most is more her practice herself as an artist. Her never giving up, obviously that was never even a part of her thought process, but the fact that she was, it's true that all of her work is different, but it does have, she has a singular vision, and she goes from one, she just keeps expanding that one thing that she really, and every time she does, it gets better. It doesn't become redundant or, okay, enough of that, you know, ever. It just gets better and better, I'm sure will continue to. I would say that it's in that way that she influenced me the most, in the sense of not giving up. And another thing was the fact that because her work was always, like, she knew exactly what she was doing, and I always felt I don't. I really don't. And I think that I finally
learned a little bit through her and her work that, in fact, maybe I do know what I'm doing. And so, I mean, these are only, I have to be absolutely honest and about it. It's her as a person who influenced me, and I also think, but her as a person who was also an artist. And so, and I think that's a really important thing in my life, and when I teach or anything else, is when I like artwork, that's one thing, and what I want to teach it and everything. Usually, the artist behind it is somebody I want to know. So it's not. I think the person and the art together will teach me a lot more than just the work, for example. So I think that with her, that was another really important thing. Yeah.
And I have a question for Anne. In the same vein, Lynne was obviously a strong and engaging personality. When you worked with her on two exhibitions and no doubt had many discussions when you acquired her work, how did you negotiate the balance of power? What was your relationship with, like? I mean, go beyond the framing orders.
I became paranoid. Perhaps you mentioned it to a new aesthetic, I think that's she's getting at me. You know, she was, I mean, this sounds kind of psychopathic to me, but she was really great to work with. She definitely had her own views on things, and so I think I mentioned to you in the email about the publication.
I wonder, yeah, if there's a story behind that.
Well, you know, Bill Ewing worked on the project because the catalog was published collaboratively between the National Gallery of Canada and Thames and Hudson, and Bill has a really good eye for laying out books and so on. And so he and Lynne and I spent many an hour with all the work spread out in our cataloging room and looking at you know, juxtapositions and layouts and so on. And I started to realize that Lynne was such a force in and of herself that there was no way that a publisher or someone like Bill, who's a, you know, curator and so on, was going to tell her how to do something that she didn't want. So I felt comfortable with that. When we got to the final sort of design phase where the Formica background is being used for the section pages, then I stepped in and said, no, I really don't like this. But the two of them were so convinced, and I realized that, you know, I'm a little bit more conservative in things that, well, like the framing and so on, but I'm really glad in the end that she went over with the Formica frames. I couldn't argue that one down. That was totally, I mean, you know, we had to change our budget for the Formica frames, et cetera, et cetera. But she had such a strong rationale for it, and the point that she made about museum, the sort of, you know, I think we were using Nielsen framing at that point, it was like vertical, bright, shiny, so, and often it's just completely in opposition to the work itself. So there was a lot of dialogue. It never became acrimonious. If we had any sort of arguments, it was probably more about politics or something else, but they were never acrimonious either. Because she did like a good, strong discussion, and always there was a great deal of humor. As I say, she just loved the fact that I lost the battle on my girlfriend. So, yeah, no, I thought she was great to work with. Yeah.
Deborah?
I could give several anecdotes, but relating to your question that you gave Lorraine, I once was sitting on a jury with Lynne, and you were working on
it. How much of
it was? It was terrific. But one of the comments that she brought up about your work that she valued very, very much, and that meant something very specific to her, was consistency. She talked about it in relationship to your work, and I think she had a very particular meaning for what that meant to her, that she was looking for.
Thanks, Deborah.
Thank you very much for saying that to me.
Justin. I've been teaching quite a lot, and I'm amazed at how important and resilient her work has been to see changes in thinking about photography and how it can be analyzed according to different paradigms, maybe 25, 35 years ago, contemporary look at it, and it still is rich. The reliance on observancy and looking, which is kind of an old-fashioned core trait of purist photography, is very much required in order to access and understand the work. As a teacher, I've often used the work as examples of that, exercises in looking and discussing. But at the same time, the work gets richer as you begin to see how it's informed by prior art and artists. You mentioned it, Diana, artifice. Her work is clever in its coding and acknowledging of some very sophisticated discussions in art, particularly beginning around conceptual art. And I love to work with that, with students, and point this out. In particular, the kind of things that you would see down in Marfa, Texas, it's all through the report. I guess what I'm saying is a teacher, it's invaluable to you. As an example, which can be read at a fairly elementary level, and we can discuss, you know, whether it has documentary properties or not, the resistance to seeing it discussed that way, and how it's all about what's external to the camera, where she puts the tripod, what she decides is important, and there's a kind of social interior space which is culturally connoted in a very serious way. And I like to use it as a defense in my own teaching and in opposition to the current fashion for constructing, which is, frankly, I think there's more out there than I can imagine, or any particular artist can imagine, and build to be photographed. And I love it for that. It's such an intense argument in favor of, you know, the external world being the source for your art and setting up a dialogue between that world and yourself, rather than setting up a dialogue with yourself, which is often a very common creature in art schools and teaching. That's it.
I think it's a very important observation where Lynne's work is concerned. Thanks, Justin. Carol.
I have a question for Lorraine. We've been talking, and Anne had talked too, about the sort of influence that is that. Clearly, it influenced your teaching. I think you grew up with your comments highlighted that. So, the kind of Danner's kind of care with observation, she took her own work, influenced pedagogy in her teaching. And I kept wondering, when you were speaking, who the influence flowed from? So, these years of being such a dedicated and highly influential teacher, do you think there was an impact on the work? I mean, maybe all three of you could talk about it. Do you think you're sure it's working with students so effectively when such a caring is in the group?
Not really. At least not in the way you're saying. I guess it's the same as answering the question that Diana just asked me. I'm sure that she really kept her students, she never showed them her work, which was something that, there's different schools of thought about whether you should do that or not, and she really did not do that. And when a few times I said, yeah, but Lynne, you know, your work is really great, and you're the best speaker on it, and you could really, why not? And then she said, if they want to see my work, they can go to a show, open a book, go to the gallery, come to a talk. You know, she really wanted them to do that themselves, to do the exercise themselves. I'm not really sure.
I don't mean directly.
Yes.
I have a thought about that, Carol.
Does that give a frame?
I have a thought about it, and this is completely speculative. none of us, even Andrew, can get inside her head. But I was very struck when I was watching the video in the exhibition, which was recorded in 2013, for the exhibition at the Musée d'Art Contemporain. Very close up on Lynne, she's looking right at you, and she's talking about the work with a tremendous amount of enthusiasm, and it's, I have such a banal statement, but you know, her whole face is animated by this desire to make contact with the listener about what she sees in the work. And it brings to mind something, you know, you could see how she might have spoken that way in the classroom, but it brings to mind something we haven't even talked about. We haven't had the occasion, maybe in the afternoon panel you will. But she had to make, I imagine, more and more complicated arrangements to get into spaces that were in many ways off limits. And I think that perhaps the combination of her respect for other people, I mean, I think of her as an incredibly polite person, a person with good manners, a person who was, you know, who was not arrogant, and her enthusiasm might just possibly have been characteristics that enabled her to get some of those doors open. It's really just speculation.
Yeah, the thought that occurs to me where it's a very indirect influence, but the fact that she was, she never let students fall into their comfort zone and stay there. I think she, in doing that, she also applied the same to herself, that she never allowed us to get comfortable with what she was doing and go, oh yeah, this is going to be another spa of this kind. So even when she was working with color, her color got kind of, what she was photographing became coloristically more sort of tumultuous towards the end, like more kind of, it wasn't quite as classical, you know. So I think it was as soon as we were all getting used to a certain type of palette or a certain type of subject, she was challenging herself to deal with something more complex. And I think that maybe it came from teaching and pushing students, she pushed herself.
So I was one of
Lynne's
students. I was a student. And I think for me, she didn't talk about her work, as Lorraine said. She never introduced her work in class. She brought an incredible rigor. And I think as an artist, as well as a teacher, what you gain from teaching is beginner's mind. You actually have that, you're taken back to the foundations. You're not allowed to rest in your assumptions because the students aren't there yet. So for me, it's always a sense of being refreshed. And the Lynne came back to the fundamentals, the foundations, and really cultivated curiosity and a sense of developing your own vision and your own way of exploring. And I suspect that that helped her to continue to refresh her own curiosity and her own learning. That's just a my speculation.
Thank you. Interesting thought. There was another hand in my class. Yes.
Oh, Diane, thank you. Yes, this question is probably addressed to you, but also perhaps to all of us. In your comments, you actually emphasized Lynne's interest in artifice, both, of course, visual artifice, but also you mentioned the words social artifice and political artifice. And that made me think about Lynne's incredible political and social awareness. I'm wondering you might care to expand on how that is also communicated in her art.
Well, I think somebody at the very outset referred to the, it was Andrew, you referred to Wittgenstein, nothing is hidden, was it Wittgenstein? Yes. Mm-hmm. I can only speak as someone who's looked at Lynne's photographs and responded to them in my own way. You know, they're one of the things that they do is that they're extremely thought-provoking. It used to annoy me a couple of decades ago, I suppose, that there weren't, you know, dates and titles and places and that whole sort of archival influence that we museum people sometimes fall into, and her refusal to nourish that. And I think that in doing that, she really throws you back on your own resources as a viewer, and it does oblige you to look at the details. And it seems self-evident to say that everything is constructed in her work. It's not that she constructs the photographs, quite rightly, but you know, she's dealing with a constructed world. And so one, I find myself thinking about all the systems of control that she documents. What the hell, you know? I mean, that photograph that you showed of the spa, you know, it makes you think of Adam Grade, for crying out loud. It's, and you suddenly, I think, no, not suddenly, after a while, you start to see the connections. These things are not so banal. You know, they're connected. How are they connected? They're connected so that we behave and we act and think in a certain kind of way, you know. So I think that if anything's really going to be political, you know, I think that's sort of, you know, the underlying thought in your question. It's going to be about getting people to think for themselves. So, my answer is that Lynne's photographs make you think for yourself about the world that we live in. I think we're probably supposed to be wrapping up. It's 12:30. Can we continue this conversation over lunch?